Hello there. Thank you very much for joining us on the Pastor.Faith YouTube channel. I am glad you took a moment out of your schedule to listen to another one of our pre-recorded lectures. We're taking you into a live service now, and we're just requesting one thing, that you do a follow-up with your Bible as we follow Christ. Good morning, brothers and sisters. We're grateful to have you on board today and hope that you had a wonderful week and that you did not forget to seek the Lord our God through our challenges that we face. I want to talk to you this morning about some of the devastation that we are facing as a nation and as a world. It seems with the epidemic that all lives that are here are being touched in one form or fashion. And a lot of us are trying to understand it, trying to deal with it from a physical aspect rather than a spiritual aspect. And when we endure things like this, just remember, it's not the first challenge and endurance that has ever been on earth. We too have to learn how to combat our problems, our issues on this earth, even as a nation, unto God. We're going to talk to you a little bit about the curse on our land. And I repeat it, the curse on our land. A lot of people don't necessarily want to hear this type of a sermon. They'd rather have physical means of straightening out the issues that are at hand. But we're going to give you a demonstration through scripture about events like this and their happenings. Again, as I said earlier, that it's not the first time this has happened on this earth. We're going to be reading from 1 Chronicles chapter 21, verse 1 through 30. And we're actually using the New Life Version Bible to kind of clarify things just a little bit more and make them more understandable to the listener. We're going to be dealing with David's sin in numbering the people. And as we look at David's role, David was a leader of Israel and Jerusalem. And he had a responsibility to lead the people in a direction that God would have him to, that the blessings would continue to be on the nation and on the people. Now, my point that I'm bringing out today is that where leadership goes, the nation, the people follow. Now, as we look at verse 1 of chapter 21 of 1 Chronicles, it reads, Satan stood up against Israel and moved David to number Israel. Now, we have David as being the leader, but we also have Satan as the contender, who is always in the destruction mode to destroy and misguide and lead a nation. And he begins through leadership. Now, any country that has leadership of any kind, you will find Satan at the helm of changing the mind and the direction of leadership. Verse 2. So David said to Joab, his leader, and the leaders of the people, go and number Israel from Beersheba to Dan. Then let me know how many people there are. And Joab said, "May the Lord add to his people 100 times as many as they are. But my Lord, the king, are they not all my Lord's servants? Why does my Lord want this thing done? Why should he bring guilt upon Israel?" But the Bible says in verse 4, "But the king's word was stronger than Joab." So basically, Joab is trying to remind David that he does not need to number the people, because when in trouble or any type of challenges, God always came through as a deliverance for the nation. So why are you numbering the people? And if you remember, kings in the past over their own countries always numbered the people to see if they had enough to go up against any other country that was coming at them to battle. But this particular situation was different with David, because David lived for the Lord, lived under his guidance, and so he didn't need to know how many people he had. He just needed to know that the Lord was with him. So Joab left and went through all of Israel and returned to Jerusalem. He gave the number of all the people to David. There were 1,100,000 men in all Israel who used the sword, and there were 470,000 men in Judah who used the sword. But Joab did not number Levi and Benjamin among them, because he did not like what the king had told him to do. Verse 7, "God was not pleased that Israel was numbered, so he punished Israel." David said to God, he came to a understanding of what he did, and he says, "I have sinned very much by doing this thing, but now I beg you, take away the sin of your servant, for I have done a very foolish thing." And David is acknowledging that Satan got the best of his frame of mind and had him thinking carnally and not spiritually. Verse 9, "The Lord said to Gad," and Gad was the prophet at that time, God's messenger to David, David's man of God, "Go and tell David," the Lord said to Gad, "this is what the Lord says, I give you 3 things to choose from. Choose one of them that I may do it to you." In other words, listen to me. Our leaders are responsible before God, how they lead the nation and the people. Verse 11, "So Gad came to David and said, this is what the Lord says, choose one of these, 3 years of no food in the land, or 3 months to be destroyed by the sword of those that hate you, or 3 days of the sword of the Lord. This would be a disease sent upon the land. The angel of the Lord would destroy with disease through all the land of Israel. Now decide, David, what answer I should give him, the Lord. Who sent me?" So David said to Gad, "I am in much trouble. Let me fall into the hand of the Lord, for his loving kindness is very great." All leaders of the land should be like David and have a repenting heart and go to God when in trouble. And all leaders should know that when you're wrong, that you need to confess, repent of it, and go to God and ask for guidance and forgiveness, because the reflection is always going to be on the people. We the people are going to be the ones that does the most suffering. He goes on to say, "But do not let me fall into the hand of man, And the reason why David said that, remember, in his past history, he was always on the run. Always on the run, especially from Saul, trying to destroy his life. And then other men and their countries too were after David for some reason or another. So he didn't want to see that be repeated. Verse 14. So the Lord sent a disease upon Israel, and 70,000 men of Israel died. God sent an angel to destroy Jerusalem. But as he was about to destroy it, the Lord saw the trouble and was sorry. So here we have God himself, full of mercy. And even when things seem to begin to become a disaster for the people, he was sorry. And he said, this is God said to the destroying angel, it is enough. So God has the power to stop famine. God has the power to stop disease. But we got to pray to him. We got to seek him and not man for the remedy of our problems. And I say this, that we thank God for technology. We thank God for how he gives us wisdom and knowledge to come up with different things. But the one that is ahead of remedies and resolvement is the Lord our God. We need to pray to him and ask for wisdom and knowledge and ask God to lead us and guide us in how to remedy the situation. And God knows how to stop it and give us what we need to help us to overcome. So God speaks again and says to the destroying angel, it is enough. Take your hand away. And the angel of the Lord was standing by the grain floor of Ornan, the Jebusite. And then David looked up and saw the angel of the Lord standing between the earth and heaven. The angel had his sword in his hand and held out over Jerusalem. Remember, when God gets fed up with us as a nation lying and without a repenting heart, he will send an angel to deal with us. Why? To get our attention. Why? To refocus us on God. Because God has the final decision, has the final answer, has the final time frame of deliverance for us. But we must come to God as his own and wanting his help. Then David and the leaders fell on their faces. They were depressed and dressed in cloth made from hair. And David said to God, was it not I who said that the people must be numbered? I am the one who has sinned and done a bad thing. And let me tell you, brothers and sisters, this is true repentance. If we can have our leadership to repent and go to God, it changes the whole direction on how things are going to turn out. But what have these sheep done, David says. O Lord my God, I beg you, let your hand be against me and my father's house, but do not let the trouble be upon your people. David is truly taking responsibility. Responsibility. And that's what we need to see happen in leadership for our nation. Take responsibility. And when you fail, and you know you failed big, then you seek the one that is greater than you, and that is the Lord God of the universe. Verse 18, then the angel of the Lord told Gad, the prophet, to say to David, go up and build an altar to the Lord on the grain floor of Ornan the Jebusite. Ornan the Jebusite owned this property. So David went up when he heard what Gad said in the name of the Lord. Now Ornan was beating the grain. He turned and saw the angel, and his four sons hid themselves. I want to say to you today, there are still angels around. There are still angels being commanded by God. We will never get away from that, no matter how forceful, how directed technology advances itself. God is in charge by his angelical force. We must remember that. Because of the presence of the Lord. And again, his four sons hid themselves because they saw the angel of the Lord because of the presence of the Lord. Verse 21, Ornan looked and saw David coming after that. And so he went out from the grain floor and put his face to the ground, showing respect to David. And David said to him, "Give me this part of the grain floor, that I may build an altar on it to the Lord. Give it to me for the full price, and then the disease will be turned away from the people." And Ornan said to David, "Take it. Let my lord the king do what is good in his eyes. And see, I will give the bulls for the burnt gifts. I will give the objects made of the wood used for beating grain for the firewood. And I will give the grain for the grain gift, and I will give it all." But then David offered up an animal sacrifice to God for their sins. But just remember, but today we have Jesus Christ as the last perfect sacrifice for all man's sin as our high priest. Remember that. And as we look at Hebrews chapter 4, verse 14, it says, "Seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, and this is Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession." Verse 15, "For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin." In Hebrews chapter 4, verse 16, "Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in the time of need." So Jesus is the high priest, the great high priest, the highest priest, and we can't ignore him. He's the Son of God, and he was the last sacrifice that was brought for us, that we may have an approach unto the God, our Father, who is over everything. So when we go to God in prayer, when we go to God in repentance, we go to the Father in the name of Jesus Christ. This is what we do today. Verse 24 of 1 Chronicles chapter 21. "But King David said to Ornan, 'No, I will buy it for the full price. I will not take what is yours for the Lord. I will not give a burnt gift for which I do not pay.'" So if David did decide to give a gift, he couldn't properly give it, and it had proper meaning unless it was his to give. So verse 25, "So David gave Ornan the Jebusite 600 pieces of gold by weight for the place." Verse 26, "And then David built an altar there to the Lord. He gave burnt gifts and peace gifts, and he called to the Lord, and the Lord answered him with fire from heaven on the altar of burnt gifts. Then the Lord told the angels to return his sword to his holder." God has the power to speak to the angel that he sets over us between heaven and earth. "Hold it, stop it, do no more," as he spoke to this angel. And when David saw that the Lord had answered him on the grain floor of Ornan the Jebusite, he gave his gifts there. The meeting tent which Moses had made in the desert was in the high place at Gibeon then. The altar of the burnt gifts was there also, but David could not go in front of it to pray to God, for he was afraid of the sword of the angel of the Lord. As we are living today, as we turn to Isaiah chapter 41, 10, fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Now, you can only do this when you've came to God with a repenting heart, receiving him as your Lord and Savior, and asking him for forgiveness, leadership, and guidance. Because now you are in Christ, and Christ is in you. No need to fear, but know the authority you have in him. Philippians chapter 2, verse 3 through 8 is an excellent passage likewise. Verse 3, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves. Not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. This is what good discernment, good leadership does when in power. It's not about them, but it's about looking out for others to the glory of God. Verse 5, in your relationship with one another, have the same mindset as Christ. Verse 6, who being in very nature of God, who did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. This is Christ. He didn't look to be in competition with God, but he was looking, it says in verse 7, rather he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant. In other words, a servant is brought forth with a mindset to serve. And it goes on to say, being made in human likeness. Verse 8, in being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself. Christ humbled himself. We as individuals, if we're put in leadership positions, we need to humble ourselves. Not look as the mode we're in and take a power trip and try to make people think we're great. Because pride sets in, and before we know it, we have forgotten God, and we think that we are the chosen one, and we think that we are in charge of everything, and we forget to consult God for leadership and guidance. It says he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death. This is Christ, even death on the cross, that you and I might have a right to the tree of life. And I hope that this message kind of enlightens everyone in what they're thinking about our situation. And remember, when election time comes, we have an opportunity to change things at the polls and allow Christ to lead and guide. And we want to always pray that God would lead and guide the leaders of our nations to do that which is right in his sight. And that the leaders will hear from heaven and respond and do that which God has called to be done. In Jesus' name, God bless you. Thank you once again for joining us at the Pastor.Faith YouTube channel. And we encourage you to continue to have a conversation with God on a daily basis. Not many people have the time or take the time to talk to Him, but He wants to be your best friend. Also, continue to consider receiving Him as Lord and Savior in your life and allowing Him to work a great peaceful work in your life, knowing that all things work together for the good to them that love God. Also, remember to continue to repent, confessing, asking forgiveness of all of our sins on a daily basis. And the most important thing is, after receiving Christ as Lord and Savior, is receiving His forgiveness in your heart. God bless you until next time.
Who am I that the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name? Would care to feel my hurt? Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart? Well, not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me when I'm falling, and you told me who I am. That calm the sea would call out through the rain and calm the storm in me. Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. Because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me when I'm falling. You told me who I am. I am yours. whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear?